In the name of the one whose name is love, I welcome you this morning. Good morning, everyone. A warm welcome to those who might be visiting with us this morning, and certainly those who are sharing this service through our television ministry through East Link. We hope that you'll feel very much a part of this celebration today as we come and as we share our faith, sing our hymns, and share our lives together as we worship God. Today's bulletins are in loving memory of Mr. and Mrs. A. Leonard Bowman, presented by Austin and Isabel Bowman. Today we celebrate some birthdays. Branson is going to be 14. Valerie Murphy is going to be, or Valerie, some of the ages aren't in here. Oh, no, wait now. No, none of the ages are in. On November 14, that's right. Sorry about that. He will be 14 on the 14th. And Valerie Murphy on November 15th will celebrate a birthday. And Sophie Wills on November 18th will also be celebrating. So there's lots of partying going on that we know of here. I'm sure there's lots going on as people celebrate birthdays and the such. Also, just a note, the upcoming study, Advent study, Readying Our Hearts, and Gail Hopkirk is going to be the person who's going to give leadership to that time together. The study begins on November 15th, on Tuesday, and it's also at 12 noon, and then at 7 p.m. in the evening in the chapel. The reflections on biblical personalities of the first Christmas. So I'm sure that will be a time to prepare ourselves for Christmas and to settle into that very special time of the year as we prepare. Also, Melanie is continuing her work and study with you on the remits, and that continues Thursdays from 6 to 7:30. And the remits are printed in your bulletin again this week. So they are important to the work and to the changing church in which we are part of. So if you want to come out and share in that time, Thursdays from 6 to 7:30 with none other than Melanie giving leadership. I think these are announcements. Well, we have two wonderful, gifted individuals here that like to share some other wisdom other than I've given. So I'm going to invite them to come forward.
Good morning. They let me come upstairs today. It must be a special time. We're on the final countdown. The Christmas fair's around the corner. The preparations continue, and we could use some help. We start today, actually they started yesterday, with the setup of the books. There are hundreds of books to choose from, and it takes time for them to do the display. So they start today, and they'll work all week on them, so take a visit to the book room on Friday. Over the next few days, we'll need help moving tables and boxes from all the various storage areas that we hide things here at Trinity. If you have time, call us. We'll find you a spot. If you're into the baking, there are containers that are available, and they'll be available after church. Meet me downstairs in the elevator room, and we have them there. The baking, sewing, candy, jams, jellies, and silent auction items are due on Thursday, and they can be delivered here to the church or picked up till 7 o'clock in the evening. So once we are all assembled, Boomer told me the other night that we'd have great weather. He guaranteed me at least plus 10. So on Friday, our guests will arrive. Let's make them feel very welcome. Let's all come for the fair. And don't forget, to stay for lunch. Friday, lunch is carrot soup and turkey soup, and our gourmet turkey sandwiches and ham sandwiches. On Saturday, we'll have our normal, usual, delicious seafood chowder made by the Culinary Institute. And again, probably some turkey soup left over, at least I hope we will. And again, the fresh sandwiches. So come on Friday and on Saturday, November the 18th and 19th. When I checked my iPad this morning, it told me I had 4 days, 15 hours, 16 minutes, and 21 seconds, give or take. So Santa's just checked off her list. Merry Christmas.
This appears to be commercial morning. Funscript. It's been a while since I've spoken about Funscript. For those who don't know what it is, it's a program that we have at the church whereby we sell gift cards from about 50 different national companies. And from these sales, we get a percentage ranging from 2 to 8% or so. To date, this year, we've made $3,200. And I'd like to get it up to $5,000 by the end of the year. Christmas time is coming, and this is really our big time of the season. It's an easy gift to give. Everyone likes them, even kids like them, because they can go out and buy whatever they want with the gift card. So I'd ask you to consider the gift cards at Christmas time. Some people use credit cards for points, and in speaking to those people, I would like to say, why not buy your gas from us, or groceries, or special big purchases? Pick out one of those. Thereby, it's a kind of a compromise. We get something, and you still get something. Finally, I would like to say that everybody at this Christmas season, we would like to see you all buy the gift cards from us. Again, as I said, $5,000 is what I'm aiming for. The tickets can be purchased at the church office during the week and on Sundays at the Richmond Street entrance where I'm located or someone else will be located. And finally, I just wish to say thanks to all of those who really support us in this program. Thank you.
From this candle comes warmth and light. As God's light shines in us, people of God, come with joy to this place. Let it be known in all the earth. Give thanks to the Lord and call on God's name. Let us praise God as we raise our voices in song with our, from Voices United, hymn 42, Praise God for This Holy Ground. Will you join with me in prayer as we share in the prayer of approach followed by the Lord's Prayer? Let us pray. God, we gather before you now, ready to give you our attention, our praise, and our love. We reach out to you even as you reach for us. We pray that in this hour of worship and beyond, we may know the strength of your presence. Turn our hearts and our minds so that we may focus fully upon you. Honor, glory, and praise be to you, Holy God, as we pray together these familiar words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we remain seated, let us sing our children's hymn, which is Jesus Bids Us Shine. And during the singing of that, the first part of that hymn, I would invite the children to come forward for a time of conversation. He's one of your favorite cousins. Wow. Hi there. Come on up. There's lots of room. So, good morning, everyone.
Greg.
What?
I was just noticing that clock's not working. So, could you tell me what time it is so I'll know when
Don't
you're
gone?
Don't
you have
gone?
A watch?
Well, oh, yeah, but it's not really.
Not working? George should probably buy you, you know, a nice Christmas gift there. It's 10:45.
Thank you.
Okay. So, thank you. Okay. Well, you know, it's really, really nice to see you this morning.
Greg, I'm just thinking, if it's already 1:45, how long do you think you're going to be here? Just so that I have an idea how long the service is going to be.
I thought we talked about this, but I would, you know, about maybe 10, 15, 20 minutes?
Okay, great. Okay.
Cool, all these interruptions. Anyway, I guess ministers should talk before they, you know, go into the service and that. But
Greg, I was just wondering, I guess I wasn't really paying close attention. Did we announce Gail's Advent study?
Yeah, we did.
Okay.
Yeah, I think we did.
Just wanted to
announce?
Make sure.
Yeah. Okay, these interruptions, my gosh, yeah. Anyway, it's hi there, guys.
Greg, did we decide if you were staying in worship today or are you going out with the children?
I think I'm going to go out with them.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Just wanted to make sure I have all this right.
I thought we talked about that, but okay. It's really good to see you this morning. Do you find sometimes we have interruptions when we're doing things? When have you seen us have interruptions? Did you notice any interruptions?
Greg?
Yes.
Do you think you'll be into the office on Wednesday this week, or should we meet on Thursday?
I think maybe Wednesday.
Okay, maybe Wednesday. Okay.
That's an interruption. That's right. And you know something? Who's had interruptions before? We all have. What about the congregation? Anybody have interruptions? Oh my gosh, look, everybody has had interruptions before. And what are interruptions? Yes. Okay, yeah, when you're talking, some people talk over you or interrupts you or wants to talk to you and those sorts of things. That's right. So we've all had interruptions. And you know, Jesus had interruptions as well. Jesus did. And in the Bible, we hear about Jesus doing different things and people interrupted him to do different things. Now, all kinds of crazy things will happen to us. What do you think? All types of crazy things will happen to us as we live and as we celebrate life. There'll be mean people. There'll be mean people. Have you ever seen mean people? Have anybody's ever been mean to you? Yeah. Yeah. There'll be kind people. Have you ever had kind people? Yeah. Some good stuff will happen to us, some really good things. And maybe there'll be some not so good things happen to us. Now, all this doesn't mean that everything is really, really bad if some of these things happen all the time. Is it sort of the end of the world? It's finished. No, it's not, is it? The things keep going. Our focus and what we want to focus on is the good. And as Christians, we want to focus on how God would like for us to be and to share with each other. So there's lots of negative things and bad things that'll happen, but we focus on the good things. And we show by showing our love, by showing our cares for others, and by including people in our lives, all people, so that everyone is welcome. So, do you think there's going to be interruptions in your life?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you going to stay focused?
I'll get her up.
That's right. Let's have a prayer together.
Wait, what?
And you could repeat after me, please. Hi, God.
Hi, God.
Thank you for this day.
Thank you for this day.
Thank you for the fun times.
Thank you for the fun times.
And the serious times.
And the serious times.
the good times and the not so good times. Help us remember that you are our God. We're never alone. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
We have talked to you later.
Talk to you later.
Amen.
Amen. Don't stop that
quick. Yeah. Thanks, Mel.
Let us all join together in prayer. God of grace and compassion, we come to you in prayer, aware that we have not always acted in ways of faith. Sometimes we live our days without giving you a moment's thought, trusting in ourselves and rejoicing in our good fortune. Other times when trouble comes, we want to blame you for not being there to prevent it. Yet you, God, are with us always, ever willing to walk with us through the good and the bad. Help us, God, to trust in you and walk in ways of faith. God loves us. God is with us in this moment, today, and tomorrow. Rejoice and be glad, for God is ever by our side. Thanks be to God. Our scripture reader this morning is Bob McNutt.
Good morning. This morning's first scripture reading is from Isaiah, chapter 65, verses 17 to 25. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. Our second responsive reading is from Isaiah 12, and you'll find that in Voices United, page 880. I will praise you, O God. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid.
For you, God, are my strength and my might. You show yourself my strength. Proclaim God's love.
With joy we draw water from the wells of salvation. Make known God's deeds among the nations. Sing praises to God, whose work is glorious. Let it be known in all the earth.
Shout for joy, you who dwell in Zion, for the Holy One of Israel is majestic among you.
Our second reading this morning is from Thessalonians chapter 3, verses 6 to 13. Now we command you, beloved, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to keep away from believers who are living in idleness and not according to the tradition that they received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you, and we did not eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labor, we work day and night, so that we may not be a burden on any of you. This was not because we do not do right, but in order to give you an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we gave you this command: anyone unwilling to work should not eat. For we hear that some of you are living in idleness, mere busybodies, not doing any work. Now such persons we command and exhort in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly and to earn their own living. Brothers and sisters, do not be weary in doing what is right.
And our gospel reading today is taken from the Gospel of Luke. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was ordained with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be, and what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and in various places famine and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all of this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed, even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will not put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your souls." Hear what the Spirit is saying to you.
Visit us with thy salvation.
Thank you. I don't know that there has been a time in history when someone has not said, these are hard times. These are difficult times. And while I have to admit that I have lived in, I think, very good times, one only needs to listen to the news to realize that this age has troubles and hardships of its own. I've yet to meet anyone who is not troubled by the results of the US election and all the potential implications. CBC Radio was interviewing people on the streets of Charlottetown on Wednesday to get a sense of people's reactions to the election results, and shock and disbelief were very common, but always there was a sense of fear. And since that time, there have been some disturbing incidences of hate and division in the States, and there have been petitions and clear statements of opposition circulating the internet. And I can't really claim to be one who follows politics, nor am I going to make any kind of judgment on the American election. But there is fear that we may be in for difficult times, where the kind of values that we as an affirming congregation profess may be challenged by people with power. These are hard times. We cannot just point our finger at those south of the border. We Canadians have our issues too. And I think Canada is a great country, and we can definitely do some patting ourselves on the back for the many social issues that we have confronted. I am glad that we are world leaders in welcoming and embracing people of different race and different religions and genders. And I'm pleased to be where children are valued and seniors respected. And I celebrate this wonderful, diverse country we live in. But we have a long way to go. Almost a month ago now, there was disturbing news that I still find unsettling, and that was hearing that three girls, the ages 12 to 14, had committed suicide. And since then, a 10-year-old took her life. And if that isn't disturbing enough, I was dismayed by the way that the deaths were reported. I only happened to catch the end of World Report that morning, just in time to hear this horrible news. At the end of which the announcer said with a certain sense of urgency, but now back to our top story. In other words, the story of real significance. The top story that day was the death of Jim Prentice in a plane crash. And no doubt this man contributed much to our society. But I was saddened to think that his life and death was regarded as more significant, more newsworthy than the suicides of children. And I couldn't help but wonder if it was because they were Aboriginal children. Did you know that the suicide rate for Aboriginal children is 10 or is 5 times the national average? There are hard times right here in Canada. And there are hard times globally. Climate change and human greed are changing our planet, and not for the better. The Earth itself seems to be threatened. We see pictures of polar bears starving. Oceans are being polluted, and land is being poisoned by our need to expand and grow. And if we think that the troubles of the world are out there, far removed from us, then go for a walk out the doors of this very church. Just a few blocks away, youth are panhandling on the streets, trying to raise some money for a place to stay and something to eat. And maybe I was blind, but I don't really think they were there just a few years ago. Times are hard. People are struggling all around us. There has not been a time in history when someone has not said, these are hard times or these are difficult times. Now, I still think that we live here in very good times. But we'd be wrong to pretend that all is well or ever has been. History has a long record of challenges and hardships. And while the challenges that we face are different, when we think about our community and our nation and our world and the hard realities that many face, then perhaps we might be able to imagine just a little how it might have felt for the people of Jerusalem. There were hard times for the people listening to the prophet Isaiah and the ones gathered around Jesus and the people of Thessalonica reading Paul's letter. The people of Isaiah spoke to were looking at a city that was literally lying in ruins. Two generations had already gone by since they returned from exile, and yet their homeland had by no means returned to its former glory. Imagine Isaiah walking through the ruins of the city where home and market literally lay in piles of rubble, and where people were hungry and thirsty. Sorrow and grief were all around as people mourned the loss of family and friends and faced economic injustice and political turmoil. The first generation had come home excited and full of hope and energy, but by the time two generations have passed, there's hardship and deepening discouragement of failed dreams. It was a hard time. By the time Jesus comes along, the people are living under Roman occupation. And sitting with Jesus, looking at the temple, they want reassurance that things are going to get better. And instead, Jesus responds with unsettling, though clearly apocalyptic imagery, of wars and earthquakes, famine and plagues. And if that isn't unsettling enough, then he warns his followers that before any of that's going to happen, they themselves will personally face persecution, betrayal, prison, and possibly even death. And then he says to them, "Don't worry, this is going to give you a great opportunity to testify." Now, I don't know about you, but that doesn't sound too reassuring. It would take a person with great personal faith to think persecution and perhaps death were great opportunities to share one's faith. Surely those early followers of Jesus said these are difficult times. By the time Paul writes to the Thessalonians, some are beginning to lose hope and faith and have begun to figure, why bother? Why bother working so hard? For the people of biblical times, the hardships were tangible. They were real and a part of their everyday lives. And it was hard to remain faithful when they were directly faced with difficulties. But they did. It's also challenging for us to be a people of faith. And I think partly for us, the challenge is because we do live in relatively good times. The hardships and reality of our society are, for most part, something we can remove ourselves from. We are not being persecuted or facing death for our faith. We are not at war. We are not walking through rubble-laden streets. But we are aware that around our world, others are. And we do know that there are people living right beside us who face hard times. And there are people here today for whom life is difficult. Grief, mental illness, addictions, poverty, it's present here, although admittedly it's often well hidden. These are difficult times. St. Augustine was an early Christian theologian and philosopher who lived back in 400 AD. And he said, bad times, hard times. This is what people keep saying. But let us live well, and times shall be good. We are the times. Such as we are, such are the times. What are we? We are God's people. People of faith and hope. Such as we are, such are the times. So let's make these times times for faith and trust and hope. Live your faith. Believe that we live in God's world. Let us live well. Let us live in faith, that these times may be good times. And let us not grow weary in doing what is right. St. Augustine also said, pray as though everything depended on God. Work as though everything depended on you. Pray as though everything depended on God. Work as though everything depended on you. May we stand up for what we believe in, trusting that God will give us the words we need and the strength that is required. And that's hard. You know, sometimes I think it might even be harder for us who do live in such good times. Might be harder for us than the disciples. What do you think? Do you think it might be easier to live one's faith when staring down the point of a Roman spear than when our biggest challenge is how to get everyone supper before the next hockey practice or where to go on our next vacation? I don't know, but I do know we are called to live our faith like it matters, to share in the vision and the dream that God has for God's people, and to bring God's dream to reality. Isaiah, the prophet, shared God's dream, the hope that God has for us. I'm about to create a new heavens and a new earth, says the Lord, where the hardships of the past are forgotten, where there's no weeping, but rather joy and delight, where the infant will not die, nor the old person live out a full life. Each will inhabit their own home with vineyards and fruit to sustain them. Their labors will not be in vain, but for the benefit of future generations. And even nature will rejoice, and animals live in harmony. Well, it may sound just a little too far-fetched, but what a better work is there for us to do than to give our lives to this dream. Today, our faith is tested by the many difficulties and circumstances that surround us. When we look at hard times and the struggles and the sorrows that exist here and now, we can choose to look with fear and worry or with faith and hope. You can worry, or you can trust God, but you can't do both. So decide not to face hard times with fear or worry. Instead, with faith and hope, work to make these times good times. As followers of Jesus, as people of faith, we must stand with God against injustice and trust that God will stand with us. Have faith in the creative presence of God, who will put a word on our lips, a song in our hearts, and give us wisdom and strength for difficult times. God is at work for the good of all God's people. No matter how hard things may appear, at this moment, God is present in this world. God has a great vision and a bright dream. Walk not in worry, live in faith. Instead of fear, find hope. Author Libby Bray says, "These are hard times. The world hurts. We live in fear and forget to walk in hope. But hope has not forgotten you. So ask it to dinner. It's probably hungry and would appreciate the invitation." God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us join in singing hymn number 567, "Will You Come and Follow Me?" Our minute for mission. Recently, people with disabilities and their allies were invited to share their stories of living with disabilities in the United Church. Some stories were joyful, many were vulnerable, honest, and painful stories of exclusion. Some people reflected on how they could not physically access a church. Some noted that their disability was the only thing others noticed or asked them about. Some shared that they could not participate fully in the community of their faith. Some explained how difficult it is to read the Bible passages that talk about healing from disabilities. Many noted attitudes of exclusion and that people with disabilities are not always welcome. United Church staff and elected members are working to address the hard realities of these stories expressed by offering new ideas about theologies of disabilities, sharing those widely in the United Church, and developing educational resources that will soon be available to communities of faith. A group of people with disabilities and their allies has been following up on ideas through a United Church consultation on disabilities and developing new ones for the church. These are positive ways people with disabilities are changing the church, and they invite the whole church to be part of authoring a new positive story. Our gifts for mission and service make it possible to be part of the new accessibility story that is being written. Please consider making mission and service giving a regular part of your life of faith. God calls us to faithful living. As this morning's offering is received, may we give not just from what we have earned, but give also of ourselves. Let us pray. Loving God, we stand before you offering our gifts, gifts of money, but also lives of faith. We stand committed to be your people, trusting that you will be our God. We pray that all that is offered here may be used to enable the life of this congregation and bless the lives of many around the world. Amen. Let us pray. Ever faithful God, whose Spirit surrounds us always, offering us strength and courage, hear our prayers as we come before you now as a people of faith. We admit that sometimes the news makes us scared and we respond in fear rather than hope, but we know that you are with us and that we must trust in you. We make the world what it is today. Help us to work to make it a great place for all people. We thank you for the many blessings that surround us. We know how wonderful the world can be. We thank you for the beauty of creation that we see in the sunrise and the wonder of your majesty we behold in the starry night sky. We thank you for the times that family have been there to help us and friends have made us laugh. We think of others, strangers who have helped us through the work that they do, whether it be building smooth roads, finding cures for disease, or growing food for our tables. Thank you for the many ways your people serve one another. Lord, we pray for your people, people who find life hard. We pray for the people of the United States and others around the world who right now are afraid of what the future might hold. Let us place our trust in you. We pray for people living in lands where war and injustice prevail and peace seems beyond reach. We pray for those who fear natural disasters like earthquakes and tsunamis. May they find hope. We offer prayers for those here in our own communities that face hardship, whether financial or emotional or health-related. Comfort them, we pray, and help us to find ways to brighten their days. Embrace all your creation, God, that your vision for a new heaven and a new earth may be a reality, and all creation may truly live in harmony. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite everyone to join in singing hymn number 691 from Voices United, Though Ancient Walls.
Thank you.
surrounded by the love of God, assured that Jesus is by your side, knowing that the Spirit is at work in you and the world. Go forth with confidence and joy to live the life which God calls you to.